Okay, this is Jitte Wagen, and this is the first video in a series of videos about the use of QGIS, and the whole series of the videos is intended as a general introduction on how to use the basic functions of QGIS, and to get you a little bit familiar with the program and its possibilities. Now, in this first video, I will introduce the QGIS components, the interface of QGIS. I will give a quick overview of the features of the program, and then I will show how to create a layer or how to manipulate the symbology, the style of the layer, how to display labels of the information in the layer, and how to save the program the project afterwards. Okay, so to start, QGIS basically consists of two components: the QGIS browser and the QGIS desktop. And the QGIS browser, we'll start with that here on the right, is actually a very neat little program that allows you to explore your spatial data sets. Now, just as a side note, along the way of this introduction, and maybe also in later videos, I will be making references to ArcGIS, which is probably the most used and the most widely known GIS program on the market. It's certainly the biggest player on the market, at least for commercial use. And so it's quite likely that if you see this video and you're interested in QGIS, you might have some familiarity with ArcGIS. And therefore, I think it's worthwhile to point out the similarities and the differences between QGIS and ArcGIS, so you get kind of a better view of the landscape of different programs and on what a GIS essentially is. Okay, so having said that, coming back to the QGIS browser, this is very similar, or almost completely similar, to the ArcGIS Arc Catalog, which is also a tool that you can use to explore your spatial data sets. Now, why is this useful? Why do GIS programs develop this kind of component? It is because spatial data sets are notoriously a bit complex. Usually, spatial data sets do consist of several files per data set. So, for example, I have here a bunch of shape files, and we're looking at these shape files using the basic Windows Explorer. And you can see a series of files with the same name but a different file extension that actually all are part of one spatial data set. In this case, one shape file, which would be one layer in our GIS. Now, the big advantage of our browser, our QGIS browser, is that it shows such a file as a single object. This is convenient for getting a good overview of your data. You're not confused by all these different files. And also, if you would want to work with those files, you would want to move them, copy them, or place them in another folder, you wouldn't have to pay attention to all the individual files that you see through the Windows Explorer. You can just move the shapefile as it is displayed in the browser, and you won't have to worry about all those individual files. Now, why is that so important? If you would haphazardly move all but one of these files, you would miss an essential part of the information, and this information could just be missing if you would subsequently load the shapefile into your GIS, but it could also simply not display if you would, for example, forget the file with the .shp extension, which is actually storing the vector information. You would simply not see any data. Okay, so this is why these browsers are useful. They have another couple of features which make them very useful. You can directly, via these steps, look at the metadata of individual shapefiles. You can look through the preview at their actual content. And finally, you can use the attribute step to look at the attached attribute tables, which can be very useful to very quickly get an idea about the data in your data set without having to open the full QGIS program. Okay, so that basically covers the QGIS browser component. So let's get to the main QGIS component. Well, this is what you see here, and this actually is very similar to what you may be used to from ArcGIS. In the center, you have a map view. Below your map view, you have all your spatial information, so the coordinates at the location of the cursor, you have scale, magnifier, rotation, rendering. Actually, if you would have a lot of data and you would navigate through that data, it would continuously render, and it may take up a lot of computational power and thus time. So you could also switch rendering off, exactly similar to what ArcGIS offers as an option there. And finally, you see the coordinate reference system. to the left, you have your browser panel and your layers panel. Now, your browser panel is more or less the same as your QGIS browser and allows you to browse through your spatial data sets and look at your files as if they were one single physical file. Another additional useful feature here is that you can simply drag from your browser panel a layer that you would want to, or a file that you would want to turn into a layer directly into your layers panel. Now, if you do that, you have to set the coordinate reference system, which in this case would be WGS84UTM Zone 32N. Now, this is not magic. I set this reference myself. I just have to indicate that it's valid for this this file in this project. Now, once you add a layer, or a shapefile, I should say, as a layer to your layers panel, it will display, and you can you can work with it in any which way you want. Now, this layers panel, of course, works very similar, or completely similar, I should say, to ArcGIS layers, because that is just the concept of layers in a GIS, and you are able to change the order of the layers, to switch them on and off, and to manipulate the individual layers in any which way you want. Okay, so I just wanted to create a pretty picture, so I will just very quickly manipulate this. I will come back to this later, but I just wanted to show you the effect of changing the color, changing the line, and thereby creating a nice representation of the data in these layers. I want a solid line, and I want this to be black. So, okay, so this is a nice representation of the archaeology, that the archaeological features that are represented in the shapefile. To be complete, this is archaeological data from a project in southern Italy, Puglia to be precise, excavation at Li Castelli di San Pancrazio. Excavations, and we're looking here at a Hellenistic structure with another structure below it, which have been drawn, digitized, and are now displayed in the GIS. Okay, so that was just some extra information. So we have our browser panel, layers panel, and to the right we have our processing toolbox. And again, this is similar to the ArcGIS Arc Toolbox, and basically gives you access to all the tools and instruments to manipulate your data with. And actually, these are basically all algorithms. Now, these algorithms are called here geo algorithms, but basically these are just algorithms that work somehow with your spatial data. It is important to understand that although the interface is similar and both programs of course work with algorithms on your spatial data, which is one of the two pillars of GIS. One is the ability to display and browse and visualize spatial data sets in layers, and the second pillar is modifying your data and working on it with algorithms, analyzing it, basically two pillars of GIS. It's important to realize that these algorithms may not be exactly the same algorithms as used in other GIS programs. They may have similar names, and interpolation algorithms or what have you, nearest neighbor algorithms, etc. But it doesn't mean that the mathematical procedure is exactly the same. And this is always important if you work with the GIS and you have a pro to understand the outcomes of your analysis. You have to check what specific type of algorithm your program uses, and to be very complete, you should also publish that because it may influence your results. Now, having said that, basically the functioning of the toolbox is similar. You can just click on the tools that you want to use and you will get a menu, a window that allows you to interactively work with them. Now, surrounding the panels, you have a whole bunch of toolbars with tools in them. These are basically shortcuts to all the options in the menu. I will not go through the menu and all the toolbars. I have to choose one. So to be complete, I will just go through the menu and tell you a little bit about the functions and the possibilities that the menu gives us. Okay, so to start, the first option, menu option, is project, which of course allows us to create new projects, open projects, create projects from template or open recent projects. It allows us to save projects as an image. It allows us to manipulate project properties, for example, setting coordinate reference systems. And it allows us access to the composer. Now, this is yet another difference with ArcGIS. ArcGIS, in order to assist you in the creation of a map, actually below the map view has two tabs, and one is data view and the other is map view. And in the map view, you can start making a map, adding a legend, north arrow, scale bars, and what have you. In QGIS, this is a completely different component. So if I would want to make a map, I would select new print composer, and a different window would open with a whole range of options, and we will get there in the last video of this series, and that will allow us to make a map. So that's called composer in QGIS, allows for map making and printing. Okay, so the second menu options is edit, and this edit menu completely refers to editing vector data. The difference of vector and raster data is assumed that you know what the difference is between the two. Basically, two different approaches to spatial data sets, and has a whole range of each has its whole range of file types associated with it. And the edit menu gives you a lot of options to manipulate the individual vector geometry types in your file. And as you probably know, a vector file can store either polygons or polylines or points, and all these tools refer to the different options that you have with those those geometry types. Now you see that all the options are grayed out. That is because there is no layer set to editable. Again, similar to ArcGIS, you have to set a layer to editable, which through the menus, I'll jump forward to the layer menu, goes by toggle editing. There's this shortcut in this toolbar. And if you click that, you set it to editing. You can see that the polygons on your screen are not just displayed as shapes, but now are displayed as actually as lines, closed lines with all the vertices, which I believe are called nodes in QGIS, indicated by red crosses. And now you can see that a whole range of these, a whole bunch of these options here are now made available. You can cut features, copy features, paste features. In order to do this, you have to select one first. So that's why this is grayed out. You can add features. You can rotate features, simplify them, add parts, delete parts, reshape them, split them, etc., etc. Okay, so that's the edit menu. I will toggle it back, so I lock basically the layer for editing. Now, the next setting, the next menu option is view. The first four options are about navigation through the map. So the first one is panning, so you can pan through the map. You can zoom in, zoom out, which is also, by the way, simply available using your mouse wheel. The next one the next couple of features are about selection and identification, measuring and statistical summary, and I will show them in a second. But first, for the third set of options, you have zooming options. Zoom to full, so you zoom to the full extent of your spatial data set that you currently have selected. Not selected, but have in your GIS. Zoom to layer, zoom to selection, etc. Now, in this case, zoom to layer is useful because that brings into full view the extent of this layer. This layer. And then, for example, back to these options available here, we can use all kinds of different means of selection. For example, select individual features or draw by rectangle, select features by polygon, freehand, radius, select by expression, select features by value, etc., etc. And these are tools which are very useful if you work with large data sets and you need to have, well, for example, all stones from your archaeological features or something. So this is already something that you can use very well to manage your data sets and do some first visual inspection of that data. Now, select features. As I said, you can draw rectangles. You can select individual features. And you could manipulate them if you would set the layer to editing and copy them or displace them or whatever. The identify features tool is also a very useful tool. If I click on that option and I click on let's keep it one, polygon, yes, I will get an identify results window here, a panel, and I actually want this integrated. Now you can integrate this by dragging it on top of another panel, as you saw me doing, and then you'll have two tabs, and you can choose the tab that you want to use, which in this case would be identify results. And what this gives you is it will tell you the layer, it will tell you an ID if it has one, and it will give us spatial data. So the clicked coordinate X, clicked coordinate Y, the area of the feature, closest vertex, etc., etc. Perimeter vertices, so the number of nodes used to draw this feature, and so on and so forth. And here you can see all the data from the attribute table. So the data attached to this particular polygon or this particular feature. Now this is probably a good moment to show you the actual attribute table of the shape file. So if you right click, you can go to open attribute table, which actually shows exactly the same data as we are shown by identify results, but now shows us in a maybe a bit more familiar table form. So you have to imagine, well, not imagine, it's the case that every feature in your shapefile has a row in your attribute table attached. So every single feature has a single row, and this row can be filled with data. You can create new fields, you can import these fields from a database. There are different options there. And as you can see here, this attribute table is used to describe the individual features. So this is in Italian, this is tipo, so it's type, this is stone, pietra. This is a stratigraphical unit number. This is the location of the excavation, the year of excavation, and so on and so forth. So the quadrant in which it's excavated, the drawings on which it is visible, the description, interpretation, etc., etc. So all the information that is typically stored about an archaeological feature during an archaeological excavation is stored in this attribute table. You can see that if I would select a different feature in or a different row in the attribute table, also in your shapefile, in your map view, you will see a different shape selected. So this beautifully shows the connection between between your features and your attributes. Okay, so back to the identify. This is the data from the attribute table. Okay, now I have this one selected. I don't want that one selected, so I'll just click outside of the shape file. It will be deselected. Now, well, the other options in the view menu are things you would probably use much less, except for maybe the panels and the toolbars options, in which you can actually customize the toolbars and the panels that you're seeing as part of the interface as QGIS. Okay, so the layer menu allows you to create layers, add layers, open the attribute table, toggle editing, save layers, and set individual coordinate reference systems of layers, turn on labels, show them and hide them. So this is all layer manipulation, most of which is simply available also by right-clicking the layer. And the under the create layer and the add layer, you can find a whole range of options. Yeah, don't be daunted by all the different types of spatial data sets that you have. There are a lot. You will probably mostly be working with things like shapefiles, because they are the most common spatial data types. But it's also very well possible that you will use specialized databases, PostGIS, online data sets which can be made available through web mapping services. You could also use, but that is not directly available through QGIS, but the geodatabase file format from ArcGIS. Okay, the next menu option is settings, through which you can set a whole range of behavior of the program, customization, configure the shortcuts, create a custom coordinate reference system, snapping options, which are basically how your cursor behaves once you start digitizing new information in vector data, etc., etc. So settings, general settings for working with QGIS. Plugins then. This is an important feature. Plugins There are many plugins for QGIS. Basically, this is part of the development story of the program. You have to imagine that QGIS is a free open source program. It started as a graphical user interface that kind of created easy access to a whole range of pre-existing GIS tools. And the program slowly grew from that point onwards by contributions of the core development team, but also for a large part of individual private developers who wanted a feature in QGIS, didn't find it, and wrote them at themselves. And you can, of course, you can write plugins in C++, which is the source code language of programming language of QGIS. You can also use Python to create plugins. And slowly these plugins have been, well, if they were useful and considered part of the basic usage and functionality of GIS, added to the program itself. So for example, we'll be georeferencing, which is done by the georeferencer option, which is now part of the QGIS program. But when I started using it a couple of years ago, it was still a plugin. So you can actually use the manage tool, plugin management tool, to access online repositories, and that allows you to get a lot of different plugins. And you know, the plugins are of course built because someone wants to do a specific process or a specific type of analysis for which there's no standard feature in QGIS, so you have to write it yourself. Okay, then we have two menu options, vector and raster, the two different spatial data types. And these menus allow you basically all the types of analysis that you may want to do with either of those. I will not go through all of them because it's simply too much. Recognize something like a spatial query from our GIS topology checker research tools, which are basically creating grids or point patterns that allow you to sample data from other spatial data sets. So it creates a random point pattern or a systematic random point pattern. Geoprocessing tools, which are all the basic options of working with polygons like union, dissolve, difference, intersection. Geometry tools, analysis tools, and finally data management tools. Raster data, similarly, raster calculator, so that allows direct manipulation of the rasters of the matrices, value matrices of raster information. The georeferencer that I was talking before, creating heat maps, doing interpolation, terrain analysis, so terrain derivatives that you can get from a digital elevation model like slope, aspect, hillshade, etc. Zonal statistics, working with projections, conversion, extraction, analysis, and miscellaneous settings. Okay, the next option is the database. Now, just as another piece of extra information, we have here in these layers, we have an attribute table in which we have data stored. Now this data is fixed data. This is saved into this file, and we can only manipulate this data by manipulating the attribute table, which we can easily do by setting it or the layer or directly here to editable, and we can edit this data. However, this is a rather simple approach to working with data sets which are linked to our spatial data. Most of the time you have a much more complex data structure in the back that describes the objects that you see in your GIS. So you may have here a description of, for example, this shape that you see here is pottery, but we are very likely to have a database which actually describes the type of pottery and the fabric of the pottery and all the inclusions in the fabric, etc., etc., which will be a big database with all sorts of different tables sorting different types of information, all in various relationships to each other. So in most setups that I personally work with in archaeology, attribute tables are absolutely not sufficient to work with archaeological data sets. So what you typically work with is an external database, which is able to contain all these complex relationships and tables, which you connect to your data in your GIS. And that's where the database manager comes in. You can use that to gain access to different types of databases and connect them to your layers or display information in those databases. You can also store spatial data in databases. Spatial databases, that you have to call them then. And then you can display that directly in your GIS. So that's where the database manager comes. Event visualization tools, this is to a set of tools that you use to to visualize geocoded information in GIS. Web, well, actually there's very little available here, but yeah, you may imagine that if you would want to work with web mapping services and things like that, and you want to create maps that can be viewed online, you could, for example, using the plugins menu, get a lot of tools to work with that, and those types of tools will then probably be visible under this menu option, web, and this menu would be expanded. Okay, so processing, well, this is all about in providing information, setting options, looking at the results of processes that you of algorithms that you have used or are going to use on your spatial data set. And finally, the help option. Okay, so this is basically a very quick overview of what QGIS offers in terms of options and possibilities. I would like to finish this this introduction with just giving you a very quick taste of how you can work with the data that you, the layers that you added to your project. And I will do this by manipulating the style of the shapefile that we see here using the data in the attribute table. And I will label the features that we see here using the data in the attribute table. Now, in order to do this, we right-click the ambiente. We will go to its properties, after which a menu that you already saw before will pop up, and here on the left you have all these different tabs that provide information but also allows all types of interactions with your shapefile. Now we wanted to manipulate this style, or what is called in ArcGIS symbology, of this layer, and we want to give colors to each type of archaeological feature visible in this layer. Now we can go to the upper menu, which allows us to choose for all types of different approaches to the visualization of this data. And in this case, we will go for categorized. Okay, so we have a categorized style we want for this this shapefile. We will have to determine which column we want to use to create these categories. Now we'll choose Typo, which is type, typology, and if we select that and click classify, we will see that the program actually looks in the column typo for all the different terms that come up there and give for every unique term assigns a different color. Now this color here now has been set random. You can also, of course, use a gradient that goes from one color to another. I mean, there are a lot of options here. Well, this would be probably a bit strange from purple to green, but for the sake of representation, we'll just choose a nice one, and we will click OK. After which you will see that every unique element in our attribute table now is actually colored uniquely in our layer. Now, we also said we wanted to show the label, so we go back to properties. Then we go to the next step, which is labels. Again, we'll start in the upper menu and we'll ask to show labels for this layer. We will choose label width and we choose a column from which the data will be gathered to create the labels, which is will be unita, which is of course the stratigraphical unit number. And then here you have a bunch of options to manipulate your labels, but we'll leave them as default. Click OK. And then you will see that all the unit numbers attached to our individual features in the attribute table are now displayed on our layer. So we'll leave QGIS for what it is in this video. As a final step, we will save the project. So we'll go to project, we'll click save as, and we will save it. I already did it, but I'll just overwrite introduction.qgis and click save. Okay, one final remark about project management and saving your data in a JS. You have to know that what you're actually saving is not your data, but you are saving a set of links to data alongside with layer definitions, with symbology definitions, selections, layer organizations, and what have you. All the things that you do with your data, all the manipulations, are saved in your project file. What is not saved is the data itself. So the data itself will still be on the location on your hard disk where you got it from. So this data, we manipulated this data, but this is still where it is on the file, and it's not saved within the project or with the project or whatever. So you have to be very aware of that, because if you would move this data and then open up the QGIS project file again, it very likely won't be able to find that data, and it will show you a window telling you to locate that data, because he can't find it and therefore he can't display it. So you have to be aware of this distinction between your project with all its definitions and links to files on your hard disk and the actual files itself, which is also very convenient, because this allows you to have a separate project organization in separate folders and structures on your hard disk, and you can use your GIS project file to create selections and different representations of that data for very specific means and purposes, like creating a map or doing analysis or creating an illustration for a publication, etc., etc. So okay, that was the final remark about project management in QGIS, and I will leave this introduction for now. Thank you.